Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I want to talk to you about my favorite subject in school, history. I know that some people may think of history as a very boring subject in school. Perhaps they think of it as a long lecture about a lot of dead people, as well as dates and events that happened a long time ago. But I don't think of history in that way at all. No one should, because history is so much more than just lectures. And these dead people accomplished many great things that make our modern lives so much easier. We can look at historical people, events, inventions, and ideas and connect all of it to our lives today. Think about it. History applies to our existence in a very practical way. We didn't just wake up one day to cars, big screen TVs, computers, iPhones, and all sorts of appliances that make our lives easier. It's been a long road for humans to have the modern life that we live today. It took creative people to think about these things, plan out these inventions, figure out if and how their ideas would work, build and construct their inventions, find their errors, and finally make any necessary improvements to give us the way of life that we might take for granted. History keeps these inventors' stories alive for us all to appreciate, learn from, and apply the lessons to our own lives today. But how do you get today's kids interested in history? How do you get them to appreciate history as so much more than a timeline of names, events, and facts to be memorized for a test? Well, I want you to raise your hand if you enjoyed hearing stories as a child. You see, that's everyone. I don't know anyone who didn't or doesn't enjoy listening to good stories. Now, I would like you to imagine yourselves in a classroom. There are donuts on everyone's desks, and the whole room smells like chocolate frosting. There's a man in a suit and a tie at the front of the room. He is holding a big book and reading to the whole class while the students are eating their donuts. This big book is full of pictures that support the stories within. And the stories are captivating. All the while, he punctuates the details of the stories by waving a yardstick like a sword during medieval history and showing slideshows of famous art from the Renaissance period. The man offers to take a break, but you ask him to go on. He continues reading and comes to the last page, the last paragraph, the last sentence, and finally, the last word. It seems like a cliffhanger ending, though, because you really don't want the story or the experience to end. And that is how this man has managed to take a possibly boring history lecture and turn it into an enthralling and entertaining experience for his students. And his whole idea is to get his students' attention and keep it. And once he has their attention, the students want to live the history that they are learning. Another way to make history fascinating to kids is through a method of studying called art appreciation. This method was created by one of my teachers in school. My teacher will show the students an artwork, and we will describe the art and figure out the story behind the images in the painting. The paintings are like pictures in a storybook. They help us see events from history more clearly. They show us what things were like and what people looked like or did hundreds and even thousands of years ago. You can think of art appreciation like this. When a parent reads a storybook to a small child, the child pays attention to the pictures in support of the story. The pictures help the child understand what is going on in the story. Art appreciation helps us understand more about history in the same way. Now that I have shared with you my passion for history and art appreciation and what makes both so exciting together, I'm going to talk about this painting that I chose to have on the screen all this time. Let's study it for a moment. As you can see, there is a man sitting in an overturned pot, and three women are looking down at him. What can we notice about the women? They do seem to be well-dressed, like rich ladies with parasols and fans. What do we think they are doing? Well, the one in pink seems to be looking at the man out of curiosity. The one in blue seems to be laughing at him. And lastly, the one with the parasol seems to be wondering what the first two women are staring at. If we look closely, we also notice that there's a little party going on in the background. Maybe these women are guests at the party, but have walked away to come down the stairs to see this strange man. What do we notice about this man? The first thing we notice is that he looks angry. Maybe he looks stubborn too, by the way he is sitting against the side of the pot. I don't think he plans to look up and around at the women looking at him. He is also dressed in rags and has no sandals on his feet. Is he poor? Is the pot his shelter? How strange that he is sitting in his pot, looking very poor, angry, and stubborn, just a few steps away from a party. Just by spending a few minutes looking at all the details of the painting, we can learn so much about this man, and we can wonder what it is that he is thinking and feeling. The title of this painting is Diogenes, by John William Waterhouse. Diogenes is a real figure from history. He was a Greek philosopher from the 4th century BC. By seeing this painting in school and doing some research online, I decided to write a poem about Diogenes, which I would like to recite for you today. A long time ago, in ancient Greece, there lived an old man named Diogenes. He chose to be poor and to live in a pot. When others chose to enjoy a nice day, he did not. He went into town with a lantern in hand and claimed to be looking for an honest man. Instead, he found crooks, scoundrels, and thieves, those of who insulted his thoughts and beliefs. He was said to have acted much like a dog. He was stared at, laughed at, and still moved along. At times, there were insults he just couldn't take, but he was too proud to hide or back away. Just before his life ended, before his voice ceased, he said, "Give my body to the animals so that they may feast." And that was the end of Diogenes.